Dear guests, members, and distinguished speakers, on behalf of the Federation of Turkish Associations in the UK, I would like to welcome you all to our conference. This is the sixth conference in the series and has been organized in the memory of 34 Turkish diplomats and other victims who were murdered by various Armenian terrorist groups between 1973 and 1995. Throughout this period, 70 innocent people lost their lives and over 500 injured in 27 terrorist attacks carried out in four continents and 17 countries. Most of the perpetrators have never been brought to justice, and of the few that were, only some were imprisoned and given light sentences. The aim of these conferences is to promote mutual understanding and discuss issues concerning Turkish-Armenian relations, both recent and historic, on an academic platform. We have three well-known historians as our guest speakers: Professor Tadeusz Swietochowski, Dr. Patrick Walsh, and Maxime Gauin, who are experts in the history of the Caucasus, Azerbaijan, Turkey, and the Ottoman Empire. The event will be chaired by Dr. Andrew Mango, who will be talking about the Zurich Protocol and other endeavours to normalise diplomatic relations between Turkey and Armenia. There will be a question and answer session at the end of the conference. Therefore, I suggest you make a note of your questions and save them for later. We widely circulated the biographies of our speakers, but if you need a copy, please ask myself or the organizing committee. Ladies and gentlemen, I wish you all an informative evening and leave the floor to our distinguished chair, Dr. Andrew Mango.
Ladies and gentlemen, Turkish-Armenian relations have all the bitterness of a family quarrel. But let's remember, it is a family quarrel. Turks and Armenians have lived peacefully side by side for centuries. The contribution of the Armenians to Turkish culture has been extensive. Architecture, music, press, theater, etc. And in spite of the quarrels which erupted basically in 1878 after the Congress of Berlin, on a personal level, friendship has often continued. So I must distinguish between a surface of hostility and a substratum of understanding and friendship. Efforts have been made to bridge the gap, particularly in Turkey and particularly in recent years. The key event has been the murder of the Armenian journalist Hrant Dink in 2007. After that, by a Turkish nationalist extremist. There was a demonstration of Turkish grief by Turkish, not only liberals, not only intellectuals, but by a mass of Turks in Istanbul, who paraded through streets shouting, "We are all Armenians." Soon after that, in 2008, as President of Turkey under Erdogan, went to Yerevan for a friendly football match. This was known as the beginning of football diplomacy. All right, clearer. As a result of his efforts, his overtures, a protocol was concluded. Before that, a road map was agreed between Turkey and Armenia on the establishment of diplomatic relations and on the opening of frontiers. These are my spectacles.
Here.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Right. The roadmap was agreed in 2009. When the roadmap was announced, there were fears in Azerbaijan that Turkey might open the frontier before the territorial dispute between Azerbaijan and Armenia on Nagorno-Karabakh was settled. The Turkish Prime Minister Erdogan went to Baku and reassured the Azerbaijanis that Turkish-Armenian rapprochement and the Karabakh settlement should be considered as a parallel process, and that Turkey will not open its border with Armenia until the latter withdrew its troops from Karabakh. When the protocol was finally signed in Zurich in October 2009, the promises made by Prime Minister Erdogan were incorporated in it. I'll read the key two sentences. Reconfirming their commitment, Turkey and Armenia, in their bilateral and international relations to respect and ensure respect for the principles of equality, sovereignty, non-intervention in internal affairs of our states, territorial integrity, and inviolability of frontiers. That covers Nagorno-Karabakh. The protocol also provided for the formation of a subcommittee to examine the tragic events of 1915 with the help of international scholars. Right. When the protocols were signed, the immediate demonstrations against it in Armenia. The main objection was the formation of a subcommittee to examine the historical record. As a result, the Armenian opposition took the protocol to the Armenian Constitutional Court, which endorsed it, but said that it had to respect the Armenian Declaration of Independence, whose Article 11 reads, "The Republic of Armenia stands in support on the task of achieving international recognition of the 1915 genocide in total Turkey and Western Armenia. This negates the commitment to the report by scholars to examine the record. When this decision was announced, the Turkish foreign minister said that this decision undermined the protocols. The Armenians responded by saying that Turkey had added unacceptable preconditions on the withdrawal of Armenian forces from Nagorno-Karabakh and that the Armenians would not discuss bilateral relations or would not give effect to the protocol until Turkey withdrew its preconditions. Turkey drew attention to the paragraph in the protocol about the territorial integrity and inviolability of territories to which Armenia, like Turkey, were committed. So, in fact, what happened was that the Armenian government thereupon stopped the ratification process. And the Turkish government never submitted the protocols for ratification by the Turkish parliament. The Zurich initiative bore no fruit at all. But in spite of the failure of the Zurich protocols, the change in the atmosphere in Turkey, considerable change. Turkish intellectuals, Turkish liberals, and a lot of other people, my friends in Turkey, started a petition soliciting signatures for a petition in which the signatories apologized for the sufferings inflicted on the Armenians in Turkey in 1915. Mind you, they didn't speak of genocide. They spoke of the sufferings of the Armenian population. The Turkish government followed suit and allowed Christian services to be held on specific occasions in Armenian religious sites, like the famous monastery in Akhtavar Island, Akhtavar in Turkish, on Lake Van, and in Ali Cathedral. This obviously a groundswell in Turkey of people who are trying to build a traditional coexistence between Turkey, Turks, and Armenians and reestablish the old friendship that existed. That spirit, that initiative, has not, to the best of my knowledge, been reciprocated in Armenia. You can say it's easier for the victorious side in a conflict to show magnanimity and for the losers to acknowledge their defeat and the fact that they also were in the wrong. No, Armenia, for example, has admitted the folly of the efforts to create with foreign help an Armenian national state in a territory which had a Turkish majority. No Armenian will criticize that decision, or the Turks will criticize readily the deportation of Armenians in 1915. This is the current state of Turkish-Armenian relations. And I now invite our speakers to discuss the beginnings of this dispute at the present stage. First of all, Professor Swietochowski will give us the background to the dispute in South Caucasus, which has culminated in the Nagorno-Karabakh conflict today. After all, it started a long time ago. Beginning of the 20th century is when Armenian nationalism and then new Azerbaijani nationalism came into conflict. Professor Swietochowski.